I am on lighthousetrailsresearch.com, and this is called Alice Bailey, Mother of the New Age Movement and Her Plan to Revitalize Christianity by Ray Yungen. The Mystery Schools. Many people have a kind of bemused contempt for those involved with mysticism, and thus they believe that the New Age movement is a frivolous frolic into the absurd. In answer to this, I would like to emphasize two points. First, millions of people are having real experiences. Second, these experiences are as old as human civilization. It is important to understand that the foundation upon which the New Age movement is based transcends the mere intellectual acceptance of ideas. It cannot be seen as separate from the mystical experience from which it springs. The mystery schools are the most easily documented of the ancient adherents of occultism. They were the caretakers of this esoteric or hidden knowledge. These schools formed the nucleus of the religious practices of ancient nations and empires, such as Egypt, China, Chaldea, Persia, Greece, and Rome, as well as the Aztec and Inca civilizations. The mystery religions were so labeled because their teachings were kept hidden from the common people. In fact, the term occult, meaning hidden or concealed, originated from the mystery religions because the majority of people were ignorant of their true meanings. Only the priests and adepts who were initiated through various grades or levels gained insight into these hidden truths of the universe. What was kept hidden or secret? It can best be summed up as the knowledge of the laws and forces that underlie the universe but are not evident to the five senses of man's normal perception. Basically, they taught an awareness of the invisible worlds for wisdom and guidance and the development of psychic abilities and spiritual healing techniques. Wow. New Age writers often refer to the core teachings of occultism as the ancient wisdom. They also refer to it as the secret wisdom, ageless wisdom, and the perennial wisdom. Many believe this ancient wisdom can be traced back to the fabled civilization of Atlantis. Yes, isn't that interesting? Because they believe in Atlantis, which essentially is the pre-flood world. You know what I mean? They want to go back to that. That's what the New Age is trying to bring back. The world before the flood. Essentially. In my opinion. Despite enormous geographical distances and cultural differences, the mysteries all taught the same message. Happy and blessed one, you have become divine instead of mortal. The Theosophical Society. If we were to mark any particular beginning of the modern New Age movement, it would have to be the founding of the Theosophical Society. Theos is the Greek word for God, and Sophos is the word for wisdom. The Theosophical Society became the Society for the Study of the Wisdom of the Divine. The Society was started in 1875 in New York City by Helena Petrovna Blavatsky, a Russian noblewoman, and Colonel Henry Olcott, an American occultist. The main purpose of Theosophy, as it was called, was to open the door for occult teachings to spread throughout Western society. Wow, didn't they do a great job? It concentrated on the development of occult powers within the individual rather than concerning itself with simply with contacting the dead, as did the spiritualist movement. The following statement can best explain the core of Theosophy. Theosophical teachers have all repeated the old doctrine as the fundamental on which to build, the doctrine that the real human being is not the poor, weak creature he too often thinks he is and exhibits to others, but a wondrous spiritual being in the innermost recesses of his nature, a divine mystery, and that is within his power to find himself. And that it is within his power to find himself, and indeed it is his destiny to realize this and eventually become it. Although the Theosophical Society's influence has greatly waned, The Theosophical lodges can still be found around the world. The Theosophical Society was instrumental in beginning what is now known as the New Age movement in the Western world. Alice Bailey and the Coming One. In the early 20th century, a figure who would have a major impact on the Western esoteric movement came out of the occultic Theosophical Society. The actual coining of the very term New Age has been attributed to her writings. Her name was Alice Ann Bailey. Born Alice Latrobe Bateman in Manchester, England on June 16, 1880, she grew up as a society girl and enjoyed all the privileges of the British upper class. Being very religious, Alice met and married a man who later became an Episcopal minister. In time, they moved to the United States. When Alice's husband became physically abusive toward her, she fled from him and settled with her three children in Pacific Grove, California. Alice was greatly comforted when she met two other English women living in Pacific Grove. These women introduced her to Theosophy, which seemed to provide answers to her questions concerning why such misfortune had befallen her. Alice, then 35, was about to have her life changed forever. Later, in her unfinished autobiography, she wrote, quote, "I discovered, first of all, that there is a great and divine plan," with a capital P. "I discovered, for a second thing, that there are those who are responsible for the working out of that plan, and who, step by step and stage by stage, have led mankind on down the centuries." Unquote. In 1917, Alice moved to Los Angeles and began working for that plan at the Theosophical Society headquarters, where she met Foster Bailey, a man who had devoted his life to occultism. She divorced her estranged husband and married Bailey in 1920. Alice had her first contact with a voice that claimed to be a master in November of 1919, calling himself the Tibetan. He wanted Alice to take dictation from him. Concerning this, Alice wrote, "I heard a voice which said, 'There are some books which it is desired should be written for the public. You can write them. Will you do so?'" Alice felt reluctant at first to take on such an unusual endeavor, but the voice continued urging her to write the books. At this point in time, Alice experienced a brief period of intense anxiety in which she feared for her health and sanity. One of her other spirit masters finally reassured her she had nothing to fear and she would be doing a really valuable piece of work. The valuable work Alice was to do ended up lasting 30 years, between 1919 and 1949. By means of telepathic communication, Alice Bailey wrote 19 books for her unseen mentor. To occultists, the significance of the Alice Bailey writings has heralded anticipation of the appearance of a world healer and savior in the coming Aquarian age, the astrological age of enlightenment and peace. This savior would unite all mankind under his guidance. Bailey termed him the Coming One. Ew, that's so creepy. I'm sorry. This person was not to be the Lord Jesus Christ, of whom Christians await the return, but an entirely different individual who would embody all the great principles of occultism, chiefly the divinity and perfectibility of man. One of Bailey's followers wrote, "The reappearance of the Avatar world teacher, by whatever name he may be known, has been prophesied in many religions as well as in the esoteric tradition. A major manifestation is expected in connection with the Aquarian age." The prophetic connection. It is important to note that the Apostle Paul declared one called the man of sin and the son of perdition would also proclaim himself to be God. 2 Thessalonians 2, 3, and 4. I believe this coming Aquarian Messiah will be the son of perdition spoken of by Paul in 2 Thessalonians. Furthermore, I am convinced the New Age movement is his spiritual platform. Yes, the New Age movement is the spiritual platform of the son of perdition, the man of sin, the Antichrist. Too many things fit together for this to be just mere coincidence. Therefore, we must examine the restructuring of our world by those who are preparing the way for his arrival. Daniel 8:23 states, "This man will be a master of dark sayings." In Hebrew, this translates as one skilled in cunning and ambiguous speech. The world will see him as one who is distinguished and spiritually brilliant. Keep this in mind as you read the following description. The coming one will not be Christian, a Hindu, a Buddhist, not an American, Jew, Italian, or Russian. His title was not important. He is for all humanity to unite all religions, philosophies, and nations. The only one who could bring this about is the one who fits the description mentioned in Daniel. This explains the all-out effort by the New Age, which is saturating our society with meditation right now. When this man comes forward, all those who are in touch with their higher self, those who are awakened, will clearly recognize him as their unifier and give him their allegiance. We have a ready-made constituency, many in key positions, to help him reconstruct society. This will be the final culmination of the paradigm shift. Pause. Yes, I've been thinking how, not just in the New Age, but in all the things that are going on in the church, in the doctrines, and in the spiritual experiences, is all preparing people to be in touch with their higher self or whatever spirit being is influencing them. This is all preparation to recognize, receive this false Christ as the Savior, including people who think they're Christians. The spirit guide component. A disciple of the Indian guru Rajneesh made this keen observation, illustrating the potential power of this deception and the hypnotic influence of this coming one. Something had happened to Rajneesh that made him unlike other men. He had undergone some change, enlightenment, the rising of Kundalini, which is serpent power, and his being had been altered in palpable, noticeable ways. The change in him, in turn, affected his sannyasins, disciples, and created a persistent and catalyzing resonance between them. What was the nature of the resonance? The Bible predicts the Antichrist and false prophet will perform lying wonders. Revelation 13:12-15 and 2 Thessalonians 2:9. Alice Bailey described the work of her New Age Christ very explicitly. The work of the Christ 2,000 years ago was to proclaim certain great possibilities and the existence of great powers. His work, when he appears, will be to prove the fact that these possibilities and to reveal the true nature and potency of man. Pause. Doesn't that sound like a lot of New Apostolic Reformation people? They say that Jesus came to show you what you can do. Not that he was God. A lot of them say that. I'll put one right here. Unpause. These New Age beliefs have been translated by some into a Christian form, whereby terms and concepts found in the Bible are redefined to take on New Age content. Yes, prominent in this sort of trend have been people like Barbara Marx Hubbard, the Catholic theologian Pierre Teilhard de Chardin, psychologist M. Scott Peck, Presbyterian Bruce Larson, and many others. In this scheme of things, Jesus Christ is not God incarnate, but a high-level adept who, through revelation knowledge, attained to the Christ principle or Christ anointing. So likewise, since there's a little spark of God in everyone, we too can follow in Jesus' steps and attain to the same God consciousness.
The kingdom requires demonstration. Now, some people think that the reason that Jesus performed his miracles is because he was trying to prove his messiahship, his claim to be the Messiah. But that's not true. That's not why he did it. He wasn't trying to prove that to anybody, because he wasn't there to prove that he was the Messiah. That wasn't the purpose. He was there to show us what it looks like when a human being, under the power of the Holy Spirit, is carrying with them the dominion of the kingdom in a fallen world. This is what Jesus was saying. This is what it looks like. Let me say it this way. Jesus didn't heal the sick to prove that he could. He healed the sick to prove that you could. He didn't perform miracles to show what he could do. He performed miracles to show what you can do. He was our example.
Oh my God, so cute.
You're joking, it's my mom. You're joking.
Hopefully you don't forget. The following is another powerful example of what this could mean. A Hindu spiritual teacher named Sri Chinmoy has demonstrated the ability to lift 7,000 pounds with one arm. He attributed his impressive ability to meditation power and admits that without it, he could not lift 60 pounds. What had most likely enabled him to do this was the power of familiar spirits giving him and those observing this the impression this was done through the power of his higher self. This is what the Bible means by lying wonders. The man of sin, the coming one, will do this on a vast scale. He will seem to work great miracles to convince humanity we all have this great power, or as Alice Bailey called it, potency within us. Yeah, this is why, I'm sorry, the demon slayers and all the people that say you have to have signs and miracles or it's not the gospel. They're part of this, whether they know it or not. They are. The great apostasy. In light of the many who will be coming in Christ's name, I also believe that Alice Bailey prophecies, in quotations, can provide further insight into what the Apostle Paul called the second in 2 Thessalonians 2:3, the falling away. Bailey eagerly foretold of what she termed the regeneration of the churches. Her rationale for this was obvious. The Christian church in its many branches can serve as a Saint John the Baptist, as a voice crying in the wilderness, and as a nucleus through which world illumination may be accomplished. So the world is going to be illumined, woken up to the new age through the Christian church, is what she said. And now it happened. In other words, instead of opposing Christianity, the occult would capture and blend itself with Christianity and then use it as its primary vehicle for spreading and instilling New Age consciousness. The various churches would still have their outer trappings of Christianity and still use much of the same lingo. If asked certain questions about traditional Christian doctrine, the same answers would be given, but it would all be on the outside. On the inside, a contemplative spirituality would be the drawing in those open to it. In wide segments of Christianity, this has indeed already occurred. One Catholic priest alone taught 31,000 people mystical prayer in 1 year. People are responding to this in large numbers because it has the external appearance of Christianity, but in truth, it is the diametric opposite. This has all the indications of the falling away of which the Apostle Paul speaks. Note this departure is tied in with the revelation of the man of sin. If he is indeed Bailey's coming one, then both Paul's prophecy and Bailey's prophecy fit together perfectly, but indisputably from opposite camps and perspectives. This is very logical when one sees, as Paul proclaimed, that they will fall away into the mystery of iniquity. 2 Thessalonians 2:7. The word mystery in Greek, when used in the context of evil, iniquity means hidden or occult. Wow. This revitalization of Christianity would fit in with Bailey's new and vital world religion, a religion that would be the cornerstone of the new age. Such a religion would be the spiritual platform for the coming one. This unity of spiritual thought would not be a single one-world denomination, but would have a unity in diversity, multicultural, interfaith, ecumenical agenda. Thomas Merton made a direct reference to this at a spiritual summit conference in Calcutta, India, when he told Hindus and Buddhists, "We are already one, but we imagine we are not. What we have to recover is our original unity." Pause. Yeah, I used to think that I didn't think that much about future, you know, end times prophecies very often. But I always thought of it as, you know, like a big satanic religion, looking like Satanism or something, right? And now I realize it's not that. And it's going to welcome all different faiths. The thing is, though, you have to be all in unity, and you cannot say Jesus is unique, Jesus is the only way, he's the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. You can't, that will not be allowed. You know, that will not be permitted. But you can go to church and believe that you're just following one of many paths to God. That'll be okay. One can easily find numerous such appeals like Merton's in contemplative writings. Examine the following. The Christian is not to become a Hindu or a Buddhist, nor a Hindu or a Buddhist to become a Christian, but each must assimilate the spirit of the others. Vivekananda. It is my sense, from having meditated with persons from many different non-Christian traditions, that in the silence we experience a deep unity. When we go beyond the portals of the rational mind into the experience, there is only one God to be experienced. That's Basil Pennington. The new ecumenism is involved here is not between Christian and Christian, but between Christians and the grace of other intuitively deep religious traditions. And that's Tilden Edwards. What is happening to mainstream Christianity is the same thing that is happening to business, health, education, counseling, and other areas of society. Christianity is being cultivated for a role in the new age. A spirit guide named Raphael explains this in the Starseed Transmissions. This is Raphael, a spirit guide, talking, okay? We work with all who are vibrationally sympathetic, simple and sincere people who feel our spirit moving, but for the most part, only within the context of their current belief system. He is saying that they work or interact with people who open their minds to them and in a way that fits in with the person's belief, current beliefs. In the context of Christianity, this means that those meditating will think that they have contacted God, when in reality they have connected up with Raphael's kind, who are more than willing to impersonate whomever they wish to reach so long as these seductive spirits can link with them. Yes, again, I was talking yesterday about how these people that are having experiences and they're seeing Jesus and they're going to the throne room and stuff. I don't know if they're lying or if they're trying to deceive people into doing that, or if they're having a real experience themselves. But as an average person who tries to imitate them, I think that's what would happen. They might see a vision and believe that they're in heaven, but it is not heaven that they're in, because they've opened themselves up to this kind of forbidden spiritual practices. This ultimately points to a deluded global religion based on meditation and mystical experience. New Age writer David Spangler explains it the following way. He said, "There will be several religious and spiritual disciplines as there are today, each serving different sensibilities and affinities, each enriched by and enriching the particular cultural soil in which it is rooted. However, there will also be a planetary spirituality that will celebrate the sacredness of the whole humanity in appropriate festivals, rituals, and sacraments. Mysticism has always overflowed the bounds of particular religious traditions. And in the new world, this would even be more true." Okay, so when someone makes you sound like you're crazy or you're a conspiracy thing, because you talk about a new order, new world, whatever, they're the ones that are talking about it. You know, they're telling you in their own words. The blood of the saints. One of the main tenets of the New Age thought is peace, goodwill, and the unity of all humanity. Remember, the age of Aquarius is to be the age of oneness. In context with this idea, the term cleansing is quite disturbing. A number of books make references to those who are laggards when the New Age reaches its maturity. Various New Age writers consider these resistors as eventually the only hindrance in allowing this global spirituality to occur. Quote, "Remnants of the fifth root race untransformed humanity will continue to survive in the initial stages of the new cosmic cycle, but unless they increase their awareness or consciousness to the higher mind and the tempo of spirituality, they will be removed from the stream of the life stream of the race. They will be removed from the life stream of the race. Isn't that a nice way of putting it? Here's another quote. Unity motivated souls will respond to his, the New Age Messiah's call. Their inner drive for spiritual world unity will synchronize with higher energy. People opposing the recognition of the Christ may struggle intensely, but it will not be prolonged. The Christ energy by then will be so strong, people will be dealt with according to their own individualized karma and their ability and desire to assimilate this accelerated energy. The final appearance of the Christ will be an evolutionary event. It will be the disappearance of egocentric lower self, subhuman man, and the ascension of God-centered man. A new race, a new species will inhabit the earth. People who collectively have the stature of consciousness that Jesus had. Okay, so when they talk about people who believe in Jesus and don't believe they are God, you're called egocentric, subhuman, selfish, and etc. Even Alice Bailey herself, who personified New Age consciousness, backs what these three quotes imply. The new era is coming, the new ideals, the new civilization, the new modes of life, of education, of religious presentation, and of government are slowly precipitating, and nothing not can stop them. They can, however, be delayed by the reactionary types of people, by the ultra-conservative and closed minds. They are the ones who can and do hold back the hour of liberation. These must all be brought under the power of death. Wow. If one understands the rationale behind these statements, then it becomes clear what they are talking about. Those who will accept the Christ consciousness can stay. Those who won't must go. The quote about people's ability and desire to assimilate the Christ energy as the determining factor in their fate is very thought-provoking. Barbara Marx Hubbard, a major New Age proponent and supporter of Marion Williamson's Department of Peace efforts in Washington, D.C., says there must be a selection process for those who refuse to see themselves and others as part of God. She states, "He, God, describes therefore the necessity of a selection process that will select out resistant individuals who choose not to evolve. Human must become divine. That is the law." Persecution and death is predicted in the Bible for those who won't fall into line during the Antichrist's rule. The parallel between what the Bible says about this period and the statements above are striking. The following prophecies reveal what is in store for those who will preach the real Jesus Christ and the gospel of the true kingdom during this time. Jesus said in Matthew 24:9, "Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake." Revelation says of this period, "And when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them who were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, How long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? And I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Revelation 24. The following verse lends credence that this will be on an individual spiritual basis. And yet, And ye shall be betrayed both by parents and brethren and kinfolks and friends, and some of you shall they cause to be put to death. Luke 21:16. Jesus told us the truth. And it wasn't always, you know, good vibes or sunshine and rainbows. He told us the truth. And sometimes it's hard. The truth is sometimes hard. This implies that a family member or a friend may be turned over to be dealt with for their own good. It will be seen as an altruistic act. The explanation that I have just laid out would most likely annoy or even infuriate anyone involved with or attracted to New Age spirituality. And pause, I believe the New Age movement and the New Apostolic Reformation are joined at the hip. After all, nowhere do you find New Agers saying that they are going to kill anybody. It is left rather vague about how anyone will be removed. But the following channeled words by Neil Donald Walsh's God explain the rationale for what most people would consider outrageous and impossible. Listen to his God. Yeah, this guy is channeling God, and so is Barbara Marx Hubbard. She said God was talking to her. So here's Neil Donald Walsh's God. So the first thing you have to understand, as I've already explained to you, is that Hitler didn't hurt anyone. In a sense, he didn't inflict suffering. He ended it. There is no death. Life goes on forever and ever. Life is. You simply change form. After you change form, consequences cease to exist. There is just knowing. The real issue is whether Hitler's actions were wrong. Yet I have said over and over again that there is no right or wrong in the universe. Now your thought that Hitler was a monster is based on the fact that he ordered the killing of millions of people, correct? What if I told you that what you call death is the greatest thing that could ever happen to anyone? What then? Shall we therefore punish Br'er Fox for throwing Br'er Rabbit into the briar patch? Okay, this is psycho. I'm sorry. This is a very revealing statement. Traditional morality has been virtually turned on its head. In other words, according to the higher consciousness that Walsh is in tune with, killing people could actually be doing them a favor. But would Walsh think this is profound higher wisdom if he himself were shivering, sick, and starving in a cattle car bound for Auschwitz? Would he have a smile on his face if he were stripped naked and herded into a gas chamber to face a gruesome, agonizing death? I think not. Walsh is no obscure personality. He is highly respected and regarded in the widely read book and film, The Secret. Walsh is described as a modern-day spiritual messenger. His Conversations with God book remain highly popular within the Western world and are called groundbreaking. Could there have been the same spiritual component to Hitler's persecution of humanity in Europe? Most likely. Consider the following evidence. The swastika, the main symbol of Nazism, is an age-old Hindu symbol that is still found in many temples throughout India. The word is not even German, but Sanskrit. Swastika, meaning that which is excellent. A New Age book has described its meaning as representing the final stage in which the chakra is active, developed, opened, and energized by awakened Kundalini energy. Thus, the very banner of Nazism stands for the very energy and thrust that underlies the whole New Age movement. New Agers even acknowledge this. David Spangler makes reference in one of his books to the Nazi movement, which had many roots in occultism. The swastika symbol was also prominently displayed on Madame Blavatsky's personal brooch, in exactly the same style as the Nazi one, tilting at an angle to the right, decades before the Nazi Party was even formed. One can also see the parallel between Nazism and the ancient wisdom in the Hindu caste system, with its Brahmin, Aryan caste, and its lower untouchable caste. The Nazis also took the term Aryan, literally the worthy race, from Hinduism. The word has nothing to do with ancient Germany, as many believe, but is a Hindu word meaning noble or superior. Although the Nazis were militarist and racist, and the New Age promotes love and brotherhood, these facts should not be disregarded. Bailey was an idealist, but if her coming one is the man of sin spoken of in 2 Thessalonians 2, then the comparison is not so discordant. Conclusion. What we are warning about is not some unprovable conspiracy theory. In fact, far from it. In March of 2016, Newsweek magazine put out a special edition called Spiritual Living. This glossy publication presented page after page of pure Alice Bailey spirituality. The entire issue was devoted to the mystical perception that man is divine. The key to positive change, both internal and external, is present in everyone, and it also exists all around us. Whether through meditation, energy healing, or a full-on spiritual awakening, you can transcend the physical world to better your mind, body, and soul. What a lie. That's from that magazine. That may sound kind of benign, but numerous articles in the magazine promote the idea of spirits that can indwell people. If this had been put out by the National Enquirer, then this could be dismissed as nothing more than sensationalistic or exaggerated. But Newsweek is one of the oldest and most respected news magazines in the world. When they make this kind of an effort, then we need to sit up and take notice that Alice Bailey's religion has now come to the forefront of mainstream society. What this means, according to those who are sympathetic with this, is that if we are to be spiritual, we need to partake of Alice Bailey's new vital world religion. That is the end. Thank you for listening, and I will link this in the description, and you can check all the footnotes. Because the books were not cited in the article, but they're down here at the bottom. A lot of course, Alice Bailey books, but many others too. Thanks for listening.
Run.
Just one name that can keep you out of hell, and it's the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus.